Please be seated. At this time, we'll have a tribute by Gillian Devnish.
Officiating Minister Reverend Lucas, Reverend Hope and Holligan, ladies and gentlemen, good afternoon. This evening I rise to bear tribute to a lady who on August 19, 1923 was a gift so intimately created by Alton Brayton, and Rosita Braffitt. This gift was delivered to the world in the form of a healthy, beautiful baby girl named Philomene. At the time of her birth, the average life expectancy of a Barbadian was 54 years. At the time of her death, 77.5 years. Yet she was bequeathed 2 additional centuries and more. She lived 99 years, approximately 6 months. In James 4:14, the author asks a question: for what is life? Then he provides the answer: it is even a vapor that appears for a little time and vanishes away. Permit me a little time to pay tribute on behalf of my cousins and relatives, an exceptional woman whose legacy may never be chronicled in the history books of great Barbadian women, but whose vapor has left an impression in the minds and hearts and senses of all those who came in contact with her. Had life been extended just 6 more months, her placement in the Sunday Sun would have changed from a byline in the obituaries to the headline on the front page as the latest Barbadian centurion. Her sign name at birth was Philomene Braffitt, and those who she endeared herself to affectionately referred to her as Miss Griffith, Miss Griff, girly. For us, she was simply Gran or Grandmother. If we came into this world bearing gifts bequeathed to us by the divine, her gift to us would have been her gentle spirit, which helped to create a sense of safety and peace for all of us. Her spirituality and dependence on God, which assured us that with God all things were possible. Her strength, her tenacity, her determination, her love, which was unwavering, which she so lavishly bestowed on all of us equally. Her love, which enabled us to dream big dreams and to believe in ourselves and to charter a path that is built on the core principles of hard work, honesty, and integrity. Before I share with you the reflections from some of my cousins, permit me also to share with you what my grandmother meant to my sisters, Janice and Sharianne, and to myself. My grandmother represented what was pure. My grandmother represented what was pure and good about the human spirit. We have never questioned or doubted her love. For many years, I've been the closest grandchild, both in terms of geographical proximity and emotional ties, and felt like the first among equals. She loved all of us, her grandchildren, equally but in a different way. As a boy, I could remember having to share her love only with Kelvin, who she loved dearly and had a special care for because of his physical needs. There's no secret that her love for Kelvin is also genetically linked to her love for her daughter, Colleen, a love that I hope to contextualize in this service. About 4 years ago, I had the opportunity of sitting with my grandmother at 96 years at a birthday party with Colleen, myself, were there. And I tried to understand from her perspective the details of her life, a life that spanned three important political periods in Barbadian history. British colonization, pre-independence, and a period of Republican status. She lucidly explained to me her experience as a girl living in Plumtree, Morphy locality of the Draxall plantation, and she later relocated to Draxall Jump, which became her domicile until her passing. She recalls the plantation overseer riding on horse into the tenantry. She spoke about funeral rituals and how bodies were left in the house. She spoke about the carriages that pulled or tore the bodies through the community, and they were visible to all who lined the streets at that time. We also spoke about myths surrounding steel donkeys, donkey carts, and she had this fear for horses, she told me, and it was because horses were associated with death. I would not have you to think that it was her fear of death that inspired her to live so long, but rather it was a divine blessing on her life bestowed to her by the Creator for her faithful stewardship. Plantation life was hard, and work was difficult in those days. My grandmother mustered the courage, the strength, and the resilience to eke out a living despite low wages, poor working conditions, and she managed to assist her late husband, Joseph, in caring for what eventually became a family of 10 children. Although my grandmother was never a sick woman, never spent a day in hospital, sickness seemed to have been a defining event in her experience. She recalled when her mother, Rosita, fell ill, and the responsibility of care fell on her. During that period of illness, my grandmother said that she was pregnant with her daughter, Colleen. And because of the way she cared for her mother on her dying bed bestowed a blessing on her, a blessing which she said fell on her unborn child also. As the cycle of life would have it, Colleen in turn became her main caregiver up to the time of her passing. And today I wish to publicly express thanks to Colleen for her love, support, and her commitment in caring for our grandmother. I would also hasten to mention that the unjust system of plantation labor, plantation work, even in the 1960s, required that she find a replacement from her household to carry on the duties of delivering clean water to the laborers in the field. This burden fell on her daughter, Olga, my mother, who, despite her natural aptitude for academics, had to abandon her schooling to take up a position as a replacement worker in an exploitative plantation economy. It was a decision that my grandmother regretted, but felt powerless to remedy. In case you forget, my grandmother represents the latest of a generation of women who outlive the beautiful system of forced and coerced labor on the first plantation in the Caribbean. Although working in what was at that time referred to as the fields of death, she survived and even overcame the hardships of plantation life, a testament to her strength and her resilience. I always remember my grandmother as having a spirit of gratitude. She was a 25 plus year survivor of breast cancer. She expressed a gratitude not just simply to her God, but her gratitude was also to her children. She spoke fondly of her sons, Carl and Peter, who helped her in providing housing. Victor, who provided her opportunity to travel abroad. Michael, who was her strong protector. She spoke about her daughters, Thelma, Sheila, Olga, Wendy, Colleen, loving all equally in spite of. I read for you tributes from the rest of my family. I start with Margaret, her daughter-in-law, who retorts that the name Philomene aptly depicts the character of the family's matriarch. P, she was peaceful, patient, powerful. H, she was always happy. And this represents the way she felt about having you in her presence. I, she was inspirational and intellectual in her own simple and humble way. L, she lovingly embraced all of her family members and those who she encountered. Oh, she was optimistic. Yes, she was hopeful, and she was confident about the future. And whatever situation she found herself in, she was contented. M, she was a mentor and a motivator. She taught us how to cook, Margaret says, how to single-handedly maneuver the excessive load from the market back to her house, from the fields to her market, to the market. And she was nice. She was pleasant. She was agreeable. She was a delightful lady. And E, she was encouraging. But above all, she had an exceptional spirit. Diana says, as a little girl, I look forward to summer vacations all the time to visit Grandma's house, up home, as we called it. Not to only spend time with Gran, but with my aunts and uncle and most of my cousins. One of my fondest memories of my grandmother is when Gran would be eating something, maybe a fruit, a biscuit, a meal, whatever. And she would sit on a chair, and about six of the cousins, including Diana, would be sitting at her feet. And there was always enough for all of us. She managed to share whatever it was with all of us. And she shared it not grudgingly, but with a gleeful smile and tenderness on her face. When I moved to New York, Gran was there with Uncle Victor for about 2 to 3 years, and our bonds became very close. I remember after work, most evenings, I would go to her house and plait her hair, or just talk with her about her day. She would share stories with me about the family history, and I was always amazed at the number of friends she made in a short time in New York, even more friends than I did. Her daughter, Baby Sis, says, over the years, Mom has always had meaningful conversations with me. And when I moved back to St. George, our visits grew. She talked even more frequently than she would. And she would always check in on me, or vice versa. If she did not hear me by telephone, my mother would walk to my house and put her mind at ease and to call out to me. Prior to COVID, people that knew and saw her would always comment on how well she looked. Her excellent capabilities at her age were impressive. We would certainly miss you, Mom. Phyllis says, I remember growing up as a child, and many of my cousins were either living or were spending summer vacations at Gran's house. Looking back at it, I marvel at how we all fit into her home at the same time. But we all wanted to be there. As I got older, I had a habit of asking Gran whenever I called if she knew who was calling. She would always respond, "Of course, my child." She asked for everyone in my family and would always tell me, "I love all of you. And I pray for all my children and grandchildren." She would pray for protection as we traveled the busy roads and she would talk about the love of God and her many blessings. Kim says, "Thank you for always praying for me and my family. It is because of you I am here today. I remember when I was a little girl and was sick, you would put Vicks in a bin with hot water and cover my head with a towel to inhale it. I remember braiding your hair, and you would talk to me about the different recipes to cook. Gran, I will always cherish and love you. I will always cherish the memories you share with us. Thank you for your love." Cheryl says, "Gran was a mother to me. She raised my sister Eudine from we were little girls to adults. Gran would always say to me, 'Cheryl, go there and work for what you want and never look what John Doe have, because you don't know what he did to get what he has.' By living next door to Gran, I always have regular conversations with her. When she began to talk about working, she would say, 'Cheryl, I work so hard.' Remembering how she used to get up early in the morning to go and dig potatoes, and how she would spend her effort in the production of vegetables and other grown provision. She would say, 'I going to walk out, not rust out.'" Gran was a prayerful warrior. She was a prayer warrior, a lady who believes in God, independent, industrious, and strong. She would always pray for her family. One of Gran's favorite scripture was Exodus 20:12. "Honor your father and mother, that your days may be long in the land which the Lord thy God giveth thee." And there's no doubt that she indeed honored her father and mother. Simply put, Gran's outlook in life was love, reverence God, respect others, and trust and wait on God. He never fails. Mariska says, "My recall is not the best. A lot of things from my past are blurred, so I'm not able to recall specific memories. However, I share the words that come to mind when I think about the time spent with Gran. For Learnum, never bake without it. And I only ever encounter for Learnum in her house. Church, faith. There was a point in my life when every Sunday she took me to church with her as a little girl in that little yellow church in Melverton. I only ever experienced an excursion with her and that church. Also, I remember delighting in seeing her teeth. She was always early for church. When I used to sleep with her before bed, she would pray for me before we go to sleep." Mariska says, "Soup. Always love when Gran cooks soup. On the topic of food, once you were around, you could rest assured that Gran is going to put aside a portion of whatever she cooked with your name on it. Rub down. Gran loved a good rub down. And she always had alcohol close at hand. Blouse and skirt. Socks and sneakers. Even at home, a skirt with a shirt tucked in, with socks and sneakers and a hat on her head. My grandmother was phenomenal. Saint. I think of her scripture scent, her signature scent, and the smell of her house. Even if I visited her after many years, the scent was perpetual and gave me a warm home feeling. The scent of castor oil. Her simple hair care staple. Strength. Ability. Able-bodied. I often told people with great pride and their marvel at how able-bodied she was. Even here in Slovenia, I tell everyone about my grandmother who is 90 and still goes to the city to do her shopping. What is the essence of life? What are you here for? Why are you here? Each person has to discover the answer to these questions for themselves. Today we do not mourn as those who have no hope. Our grandmother has fought a good fight. She has finished the course. She has kept the faith. And I'm certain there is laid up for her a crown of righteousness which the righteous judge shall give. So sleep on, Gran, sleep on. Today, on behalf of family, I thank you for sharing in the experiences of her life and for celebrating with us her death. Thank you.
Let us pray. Heavenly Father, in your Son, Jesus Christ, you have given us a true faith and a sure hope. Strengthen this faith and hope in us all our days, that we may live as those who believe and trust in the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, and the resurrection to eternal life through Jesus Christ, our Lord. We will now have the first Bible reading.
The first Bible reading will be done by Phyllis Bynoe, taken from 1 Thessalonians chapter 4, verses 13 to 18.
Good afternoon, church. A reading from the Word of God written in the first epistle of Paul, the Apostle, to the Thessalonians, chapter 4, verses 13 to 18. But we do not want you to be uninformed, brothers and sisters, about those who have died, so that you may not grieve as the others do who have no hope. For since we believe that Jesus died and rose again, even so, through Jesus, God will bring with him those who have died. For this we declare to you the word of the Lord, that we who live, who are left until the coming of the Lord, will be by no means precede those who have died. For the Lord himself, with a cry of command, with the archangel's call, with the sound of God's trumpet, will descend from heaven, and the dead in Christ will rise first. Then we who are alive, who are left, will be caught up in the clouds together with him, the Lord, in the air. And so we will be forever. Therefore, encourage one another with these words, the word of the Lord.
We will now have the appointed Psalm, Psalm 91.
Thank you.
chapter 14, verses 1 to 6.
A reading from the Word of God, written in St. John chapter 14, verses 1 to 6. Do not let your heart be troubled. Believe in God, believe also in me. In my Father's house there are many dwelling places. If it were not so, would I have told you that I go to prepare a place for you? And if I go and prepare a place for you, I will take you to myself, so that where I am, there you may be also. And you know the way to the place where I'm going, Thomas said. Lord, we do not know where you are going. How can we know the way? Jesus said to him, I am the way, and the truth, and the life. No one comes to the Father except through me. The word of God. Here ends the reading.
The hymn?
The hymn before the homily, through all the changes. Thank you.
of God the Father, God the Son, and God the Holy Spirit. Amen. One of the most difficult things that we deal with in life is saying goodbye to a loved one, whether the loved one is 1 year or 100 years. In moments like these, no matter the age, death often takes us by surprise. And no matter how old that person is, some of us may still question why. If we read Solomon's words, I'm sure everybody's familiar with that, those verses of scripture. Solomon's words are a reminder that we all face different times in our life. We have different seasons in our life, and it is very easy to see the joy and the beauty in many points in our life. There will be times of joy, there will be times of happiness, times where we're experiencing new life being brought into our families, time where our hearts are merry and content. And then there are those times that we will be heartbroken and sorrowful, times when tears will roll down as we deal with moments, even like funerals. What we must realize is that even during those moments, that God has designed something beautiful. We may ask, but how can the loss of a loved one be beautiful? How is losing a loved one even capable of being a beautiful situation? My question to us is, who can doubt that God makes all things beautiful in their time? After all, he is God, and his word says there is nothing that is impossible with God. So why should we doubt this? Why should we doubt the word of God? And let us, for a moment, consider a seed as an example. When we have, seeds from a mango or a cherry, or even if when you look at it, dried peas. They don't look all that good to us. They just look old and dry. But in the order of things, those seeds or those dried peas, after a little time puts forth a shoot, then the shoot becomes a plant, and then the plant bears a bud, and then the bud breaks open, if it is a flower, to glorious bloom, or if it is a fruit, a lovely fruit. And God smiles on it because it has become beautiful in his time. We can also take the example, for example, a caterpillar, or even the story we heard of the childhood ugly duckling who grew into a beautiful swan. When we look at a caterpillar, I remember knowing no better as little children, we would take the pupae of the caterpillars and put them in a matchbox. And then we would open the matchbox and she said, turn to Carrington. At that time, turn to Carrington, turn this way, turn the other way. And not knowing that was a stage of the butterfly's life. But as ugly as that pupa was, you know, it turned into a beautiful butterfly, butterflies of all colors. Some flowers may not be regarded as beautiful, and some seeds that we plant may never grow. There are many lives, and especially as we look around our society today, we see people who have lost their mind. We see people walking in the street looking dirty, having no sense of time or whatever. But they've been distorted and misrepresented until some can see no beauty in them at all. But we cannot overlook one fact. One day long ago, over 2,000 years ago, we also beheld a very awful scene at Golgotha. The body of Jesus, the Messiah, had been stripped and beaten, and a cross was placed on his head. And as I think it is Isaiah, I can't remember the Old Testament book, but it talks about that he would be unrecognizable. He would be like nothing to look upon. And we're told that blood streamed from his face, his side was pierced with the spear of a soldier. We're also told that many spat on him as he walked to Golgotha. Many ridiculed him. Many mocked him. Could anything change such an awful scene into something so beautiful? But his body was placed in a grave, as a seed is placed into the ground. And 3 days later, he rose from the grave, conquering death, while making it possible for us to also share in his glorious resurrection. God had taken something awful, ugly, an execution, a crucifixion, and had changed it into a thing of beauty. And it is called resurrection. Our God is not dead, he is alive. And because of this, we can believe that God makes all things, as Solomon says, beautiful in their time. And so if we have faith, we too can have hope. For if God raised Jesus from the tomb, we too can be raised. And the Word of God tells us, if you confess with your lips that Jesus is Lord and believe in your heart that God raised him from the dead, you shall be saved. Romans 10:9. And brothers and sisters, this is not a matter for debate. It is a matter of trust. God was able to raise Jesus from the grave over 2,000 years ago. And if he did it for Jesus, if we trust in him, if we put our faith in him, if we believe in him, when our time comes to face this earthly death, which we must all face, we like him will not be buried. Rather, the Word of God tells us we shall raise as well. A time of death is a time of, I believe, ultimate healing. When Christians leave this world, they are literally leaving all the bad of this life behind. The sicknesses that may afflict us on this earth are permanently removed from this immortalized, from their immortalized, holy, perfected body received upon their exit from this world. And Paul, writing to the church at Philippi, alludes to this body in Philippians 3:21 when he writes, he will transform the body of our humiliation that it may be conformed to the body of his glory by the power that also enables him to make all things subject unto himself. Simply put, Paul was saying that the body of a child of God, a body of a Christian, will become glorified and perfected as Christ's body was glorified and perfected. Death will no longer have a hold on us, and we will never face or deal with sickness, pain, or heartache again. Also in 1 Corinthians 15:54 to 55, Paul reminds us that death for a Christian is the ultimate victory over this mortal life. When he writes, when this perishable body puts on imperishability and this mortal body puts on immortality, then the saying that is written will be fulfilled. Death has been swallowed up in victory. So where then, O death, is your victory? O death, where is your sting? A time of death gives God the opportunity to comfort. When we deal with a broken heart, and I'm very much aware that nothing I nor any other individual present here could do to say to you would heal the brokenness you may feel inside when you lose somebody. But God loves to show us his love. And therefore, during times of our heartache, God loves nothing more than to just draw us to himself. And for lack of better words, just hold us when we cry. 2 Corinthians 1:3-4 tells us, blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, the Father of mercies and the God of all consolation, who consoles us in all our affliction, so that we may be able to console those who are in affliction with the consolation that we ourselves are consoled by God. So we must realize today that while we deal with heartache and sorrow, and not only at funerals, we may be going through other things in this life, Brothers and sisters, it is a beautiful opportunity for God Himself to reach down to where we are, to pull us close to Himself and just pour out His love on us. And this is what He wants to do. He wants to comfort us during those times of sorrow so that we can taste of His goodness, we can taste of His mercy, and then in turn let others know how He can help them during their difficult times as well. A time of death reminds us to make ready. Death is the reminder that at some point of this life, we will all breathe our last breath, and our hearts will cease beating. And because of this, we must be very much aware of our spiritual condition and prepare for that day when we leave this world. Many people today are just concerned about their physical bodies. Even on Sunday mornings, when you would think that people would be in worship, they're running, they're jogging, they're exercising, and they're trying to keep their bodies intact. And we fail sometimes to understand that we just don't have, it isn't just about this body, this physical body. There is also a spiritual side to that, and as much as we nurture, or even more than we nurture this physical body, we need to nurture our spiritual body. It is imperative that we prepare ourselves to one day stand before God with the hope of hearing, as Jesus said, "Well done, good and trustworthy slave. You have been trustworthy in a few things. I will put you in charge of many things. Enjoy, enter into the joy of your master." We must realize that none of us is perfect, but we can be forgiven, and we can have the promise of one day with Christ forever. And Romans 3:23 reminds us, "For there is no distinction, since all have sinned and fall short of the glory of God." And so, brothers and sisters, it is necessary that we ensure that we repent of our sins, that we may receive forgiveness, that we may be able to stand before God one day. And my prayer for each one here today is that even though our hearts may be broken, that we can feel the embrace of God today, that we can sense His love for us and His desire to hold us during this time, and that we determine in our heart to prepare for the day when we will leave this world. And I just want to add that time is really fleeing. I heard somebody make a comment that time seems to be flying and leaving the world behind. And if I don't know how many of us are conscious that yes, the days seem to be getting shorter. And I know that I'm not talking foolishness, but people may think so. But if we look around, and if there are any persons in here who read the Word of God on a daily basis and study it and inwardly digest it, in the book of Revelation, when we look around this world, we're seeing a lot of things that we read of in the book of Revelation. Yesterday only, I received a WhatsApp, and this guy was filming. He was going through this store belonging to Amazon, and he's saying, you know, when you walk in, you just have to swipe your card, and you pay for everything, not with cash. You just swipe the card on everything. Nobody there to help you. It is just everything is just computerized, and it all depends on that card. And the book of Revelation talks about this. You can imagine if we cannot use cash, if we have to use a card, that whoever is in control of this world know everything about us. We can see the whole thing of what Revelation mentioned, that, you know, if you don't take a mark, you will starve. And I want us to, I mean, we need to bear these things in mind. We don't just live and go along. A lot of us think that, you know, it is just live. We live, we eat, we drink, we marry, we party, and then we die, and that's it. But I believe, brothers and sisters in Christ, as the Word of God tells us, there is more for us than this life here on this sinful and chaotic and confused world. And I implore you, if you don't know Christ, well, search diligently for Him. His word says that when we seek diligently for him, he will come to us. He will sup with us. So we need to look deep within ourselves, and this Lenten season is a time for us to self-examine. For self-examination, we need to examine ourselves. We need to sit down, and the same way we sit down and we watch TV and we watch all kinds of things, sit down, reflect on your life, think about life, think about why we are here on this earth. We were made for a purpose. Think about that purpose, what that purpose is. Think about who is our creator, what is he to me, and what does he require of me. All these things we need to just sit down one day and reflect on. And I'm sure when we are zealous in that kind of way, we are inquisitive and we are inquiring of the Holy Spirit, he will come to us and he will show us certain things. But we need to sometimes pause in this busy life, you know, and just spend some moments in our Master's presence. I hope that we all here can see that death for God's children is one that, while it may hurt, it is not a sad occasion, but one that is beautiful as they reach their destination, a time of beauty as they receive their reward. So, grieving hearts, this is not the end for our sister Philomene. No, her journey does not end here. Just death is just another path that we must all take. We live in a world that is constantly changing. In life, we will go through many seasons. But brothers and sisters, we can rely on one thing to remain constant and unchangeable and immutable. God, our God, does not change. He's the same yesterday, today, and forever, according to Hebrews 13:8. And in Malachi 3:6, he says to us, I, the Lord, do not change. Ecclesiastes 3:14 says, I know that everything God does will remain forever. There is nothing to add to it, and there's nothing to take from it. And this means that we can be assured of the promises of God. God won't change his mind about us because he loves us forever. We are his creation. But there's a time for change. There's a time appointed to all of us, a time appointed to everything. But God is in control of all things, and he has given his promise of salvation to those who believe in his Son. There will come a time when this earth and heaven, according to the word of God, will pass away, and a new earth and a new heaven will come. If you would be there, then brothers and sisters in Christ, now is the time of salvation. Now is the time to change. Now is the time to accept the Lord Jesus Christ. My prayer this evening is that all of us may come to know the Lord Jesus Christ. Not just know about him, but have a personal relationship with him. That is what he is calling us to, a personal relationship with God. David had a personal and intimate relationship with God. Yes, he sinned time and time again. Yeah, but he had a personal relationship with God. He was forgiven time and time again, and God called him a man after his own heart. So, brothers and sisters in Christ, I leave you with that. And I pray that you will receive that comfort this evening from the Lord Jesus Christ, the one from whom that comfort and that peace and that joy can come. Amen. Let us stand and reaffirm our faith in the words of the Apostles' Creed. It is found in your booklets, page 12. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord. He was conceived by the power of the Holy Spirit and born of the Virgin Mary. He suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day, he rose again. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Please kneel for our prayers.
After each prayer, your response will be, "Hear us, Lord." Almighty God, who have knit your chosen people together in one communion, in the mystical body of your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord, give to your whole church in heaven and on earth your high, your light, and your peace. Hear us, Lord. May all who have been baptized in Christ's death and resurrection die to sin and rise to newness of life, and may we, his pass through the gate and grave of death to our joyful resurrection.
Hear us, Lord.
Grant to us who are still in our pilgrimage and who walked as yet by faith, that your Holy Spirit may lead us in holiness and righteousness all our days.
Hear us, Lord.
Grant to your faithful people pardon and peace, that we may be cleansed from all our sins and serve you with a quiet mind.
Hear us, Lord.
Grant to all who mourn a sure and confidence in your loving care, that casting all your sorrows on you may know the consolation of your love.
Hear us, Lord.
Give courage and faith to those who are bereaved. May they know, have strength to meet the days ahead in the comfort of a holy and certain hope, and in the joyful expectation of eternal life with those they love. Hear us, Lord.
Lord Jesus Christ, we commend to you our sister Philomene, who was reborn by water and the Holy Spirit in holy baptism. Grant that her death may recall to us your victory over death and be an occasion for us to renew our trust in your Father's love. Give us, we pray, the faith to follow where you have led the way, and where you live and reign with the Father and the Holy Spirit to the ages of ages. Amen. May the God of peace, who brought again from the dead our Lord Jesus Christ, the great shepherd of the sheep through the blood of the everlasting covenant, make you perfect in every good work to do his will, working in you that which is well-pleasing in his sight. Through Jesus Christ, to whom be glory forever and ever. Amen. I take this opportunity to extend again, on behalf of the parish of St. Luke, our sincerest condolences during your period of bereavement. Our prayers are with you at this time. A final hymn, and can it be? During that hymn, we will be taking a collection, whatever you can afford, just to go towards the keep of our cemetery. I'm sure that all of us are aware, we try to keep the cemetery. We know that our deceased ones lay there, but we still have to keep them looking fresh, the place looking fresh and clean. So this is towards the upkeep of our graveyard. Please stand for our final hymn.
Come again, our
we also ask you to bless the hearts that they not have to give. And we pray, Lord, Father God, that what has been offered may be blessed by you, dear Lord God, that it may be used to the glorification of your name, for the furtherance of your kingdom in this earth, and for the upliftment of this church. In Jesus' precious name we pray.
Depart and be. My heart therefore is glad, and my spirit rejoices. My body also shall rest in hope. You will show me the path of life. In your presence there is fullness of joy, and in your right hand are pleasures forevermore. I heard a voice from heaven saying, write this. Happy are the dead who die in the faith of Christ. Henceforth, says the Spirit, they may rest from their labors, for they take with them the record of their deeds. Man born of a woman has but a short time to live. Like a flower, he blossoms and then withers. Like a shadow, he flees and never stays. In the midst of life, we are in death. To whom can we turn for help but to you, Lord, who are justly angered by our sins? Lord God, holy and mighty, holy and immortal, holy and most merciful Savior, deliver us from the bitter pains of eternal death. Now you know the secrets of our hearts. In your mercy, hear our prayer. Forgive us our sins. And at our last hour, let us not fall away from you.
In sure and certain hope of resurrection to eternal life, through our Lord Jesus Christ, we commend to Almighty God our sister Philomene, and we commit her body to the ground, earth to earth, ashes to ashes, dust to dust. And we beseech you in your infinite goodness to give us grace to live in your dear love and to die in your favor, that when your well-beloved Son shall come again in judgment, both this our sister Philomene and we ourselves may be found acceptable in your sight. Grant this for the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord.
Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Let us pray. Merciful God, Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, who is the resurrection and the life, raise us, we humbly pray, from the death of sin to the life of righteousness, that when we depart this life, we may rest in him, and at the resurrection receive that blessing which your well-beloved Son shall then pronounce. Come, you blessed of my Father, receive the kingdom prepared for you from the beginning of the world. Grant this, O merciful Father, through Jesus Christ, our Mediator and Redeemer.
Amen.
Grant, O Lord, to all who are bereaved, the spirit of faith and courage, that they may have strength to meet the days to come with steadfastness and patience, not sorrowing as those without hope, but in thankful remembrance of your great goodness and in the joyful expectation to eternal life with those they love. And this we ask in the name of Jesus Christ, our Lord.
Amen.
Rest eternal grant unto her, O Lord.
And let light perpetual shine upon her.
May she and all the faithful departed through the mercy of God rest in peace. Amen. The Lord bless her and keep her. The Lord make his face to shine upon her and be gracious to her. The Lord lift up his countenance upon her and give her peace.
Amen.
Amen.
It's so hot that even the things drain, the vines.
Precious Lord, take my hand, lead me on, let me stand. I am tired, I am weak,
I am worn. Who has done the broken night, lead me on to the light. Lord, lead me home. When my way grows drear, precious Lord, linger near. When my life is almost gone, hear my cry.
Thank you.
sweet by and by, we shall meet on that beautiful shore. In the sweet by and by, we shall meet on that beautiful shore. We shall sing on that beautiful shore the melodious songs of the blessed, and our spirits shall sorrow no more. Not a sigh for the blessing of rest. In the sweet by and by, we shall meet on that beautiful shore. In the sweet by and by, we shall meet on that beautiful shore. Our bountiful Father above, we will offer our tribute of praise for the glorious gift of His love and the blessings that hallow our day. In the sweet by and by, we shall meet on that beautiful shore. In the sweet by and by, we shall meet on that beautiful shore. In the sweet by and by, we shall meet on that beautiful shore. In the sweet by and by, we shall meet on that beautiful shore. We shall meet on that beautiful shore.
Bless the Lord, oh my soul, oh my soul, worship his holy name. Sing like never before, oh my soul, I worship your holy name. The sun comes up, it's a new day dawning. It's time to sing your song again. Whatever may pass and whatever lies before me, let me be singing when the evening comes. Bless the Lord, oh my soul, oh my soul, worship his holy name. Your holy name. You're rich in love and you're slow to anger. Your name is great and your heart is kind. For all your goodness I will keep on singing. 10,000 reasons for my heart to find. So bless the Lord, oh my soul, oh my soul, worship his holy name. Sing like worship your holy name. Bless you, Lord.
The Lord be with you. Let us pray. Remember, O Lord, this your servant who has gone before us with a sign of faith and now rest in the sleep of peace. According to your promises, grant to her and all who rest in Christ refreshment, light, and peace through the same Christ our Lord. Rest eternal grant unto her, O Lord.
And let light perpetual shine upon her.
Lord bless you and keep you. Make his face shine upon you and be gracious to you. The Lord turn face toward you and give you peace. The Lord bless you.
On behalf of the extended family, I'd like to thank each and every one for taking the time out of their busy schedule to be here to share with us and to comfort us in this moment of grief. This is a sacred spot. Here is our grandmother. And to the left of our grandmother is our uncle, who was just laid to rest a few weeks ago. At this time, her great-grandson, JD, will sing some words of a song.
The sky shall unfold, preparing his entrance. The stars shall applaud him with thunders of praise. The sweet light in his eyes shall enhance those awaiting. And we shall behold him then face to face. The angel will sound the shout of his coming, and the sleeping shall rise from their slumbering place. And those remaining shall be changed in a moment, and we shall behold him then face to face.